Joe Weixlmann is Emeritus Professor of English at St. Louis University. From 1976 to 2004, he was the editor-in-chief of the African American Review, formerly the Black American Literature Forum. Joe Weixlmann is also the president of the Percival Everett International Society. Joe, you know, when I think of you, I immediately think of the Black American Literature Forum. Talk about the birth of this publication. What was its objectives? How did it shape the conversation around African American literature? And key, how were you able to sustain it for so many years? I know that's
The last one is the tough question. Well, the front end and the back end are the tough part of that. So when the publication had existed into three issues of its 10th year as Gulp, Negro American Literature Forum, right? And so when I came on board, step number one was changing the name. Step number two was this. There were four people who are part of the advisory board. The only one of whom that would probably be particularly resonant with you was George Kent. George was then about the age that we are now. And he said, yeah, I don't think I'm going to do this anymore. And it also turned out, much to my surprise, that while there was this editorial board of four folks, they were not being consulted about what manuscripts to publish. They were largely figureheads, helped getting the journal off the ground, but that was kind of it. So task number two after a name change was to put together an advisory board that really would work in a way that allowed people to be fully engaged in manuscripts to be reviewed and so on and so forth. And so a bunch of folks were very generous to come on board. Houston Baker and Bill Andrews, Charles Nylon, Dick Barksdale, et cetera, et cetera. And we put together this group of 14 people so that the journal could begin functioning in a fully professional way. This was also an interesting time, especially when we think in terms of modern technologies, when you gave typewritten manuscripts to a person in the university office that did publishing, and they typed that into their computer, and out came these sheets of paper that you could paste down on pages and so on and so forth. So I learned how to use a light table. I learned how to not curse too much when you really had to redo something on page two of an article. You'd paste it up through page 10. You found out there was a problem back in page two and so on and so forth. That continued, you know, from 1976 well into the early 80s when computers finally got into the picture. The journal was founded initially through the School of Education at Indiana State, and it reported to the dean of the School of Education, and the person who kept subscriptions was the person who ran the switchboard, yes, the switchboard in the School of Education. And so I get interesting. One of my most favorite question from that time period was getting a call from her one day and saying, "What's this Grotz?" And I said, I'm sorry, I don't understand. Could you repeat that? What's this Grotz? And I'm thinking, you know, what the hell is she saying? And so could you spell it for me? G-R-A-T-I-S. Oh, okay, I can answer that question for you. So that, you know, there was some of the getting going. It was an interesting time.
Well, you know, when I go back and look at Negro Digest Black World, it appears that there was a lot of discussion around attempting to define a Black aesthetic. Where do you feel we are today in regards to Black literary theory? And is there an unfinished agenda to ideas we discussed in the late 60s and early 70s?
I'm going to start with a footnote to that. And the footnote is this: of there were 15 people that I asked to be on the advisory board initially, the 15th who said no, the only one who said no, was Hoyt Fuller. And he did so very respectably. A few years ago, we were at a conference together and had a long talk about it, so on and so forth. And, you know, I of course, completely understood where he was coming from. How have things evolved since then? In too many ways to answer 28 minutes. But, I think that there has been a productive and a good course toward both respecting those things that are embodied in the notion of a Black aesthetic. And there have also been a variety of challenges along the way. I mean, I was thinking of another thing when you asked that question. There was a conference that was held at Cornell by the African American Studies Department, to which I was invited sometime in the early to
it
mid
must
80s.
Have been James Turner probably at that time.
Two of the people there, of the many people there, were Ron Karenga and Houston Baker. And toward the end of the conference, last speaker was Karenga. And he went off on this long spiel, which among other things was very anti-feminist, but almost anti-woman. And there were two people who were supposed to get up at the end and do a, wasn't this a nice conference, etc. So Naomi Long Madgett was the first one up, and Naomi gets up and said, "Oh, it's so good to see people again. It's fine. It wasn't this wonderful. We really enjoyed ourselves, etc., etc." And then Houston got up and said, "I think that we have just heard about the most misogynistic thing that, you know," and things kind of blew up, but it needed to be said. So there are a lot of issues, right, around race, around gender, that God knows America still needs to work through.
Well, the thing I was looking at, Joe, what I was looking at was more, my mentor was Stephen Henderson. And I felt that, you know, when he was dealing with this concept of saturation, or when he began to emphasize the fact that, okay, when we look at Blackness and we look at something that we know is uniquely Black, say African-American, you know, he was beginning to look at the blues. And you might recall, even with Houston Baker, the discussion went from like a Black aesthetic to a blues aesthetic.
And Steve was just an amazing guy.
That's why I was wondering about, you know, the theoretical aspect of it, because my take on it, Joe, is that some of the people that were talking about the Black aesthetic were also like writers themselves. You know, they were like practitioners. Sure. You know, I remember, for example, when Don Lee at that time, Haki Madhubuti, put out Dynamite Voices 1. And he was trying to analyze, you know, people. And somebody would say, "Well, I don't like your poetry." You know, who gives you that? But at the same time, I felt that we needed to give birth to people who were critics and who were theoreticians and not necessarily practitioners.
Right. And, you know, Steve Henderson at that time was one of the first persons who really thought, I mean, a lot of people were working through lots of issues. But he was somebody who really wanted to do work that that lasts. I mean, he, you know, understanding the New Black Poetry, that book, the first 50, 60 pages of that book where he really goes through things and the elements is some of the most profound thinking that's happened since that time.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, eventually this, the theory, I suppose,
mm-hmm.
if you want to think about it that way, just starts morphing in very, very, well, in relatively different ways as we get to the point when a lot of European theory starts being undergirding all of the criticism across literature of all stripes, starting in the 70s and running up.
Well, let me ask you that. When you say that, let me ask you this next question. Did you, during your career, did you witness any tension between Black and white scholars in terms of interpretation of various texts?
Not so much Black and white. I mean, but there's much more theory and anti-theory. I mean, there was a time when theory really comes to the fore, most importantly, I suppose, in this context, through Houston's work. Skip Gates too, but mostly Houston's. And some people are saying, well, can I write just a plain old essay? Do I have to have this stuff in there? And that kind of back and forth, which at some levels I understood at the time, and at some levels I didn't. You know, there are whose line, trying to think whose line it is. There are more ways through the woods than just one. That kind of has settled to a great degree over time, although it is still probably harder now for people to do sort of old-fashioned new criticism. But there is the but there remains a tool. There remains an interpretive tool that, whether you're using a heavily theoretical approach or you're not using a heavily theoretical approach, and whatever the base for that theoretical approach, whether it's Marxism or Black aesthetic, you know, continues to be something now I think we have embraced. And excuse me, and so I think it's less of a tumultuous deal and more of a, I've got to do more when I'm approaching my writing other than just say what the words are to me or what this feels like to me or some such thing, but I need to attach this to some kind of framework that maybe is going to make some kind of difference in the world.
Well, you know, you mentioned just a second ago, you mentioned Henry Louis Gates' his name, and you were on the board of advisors to the Norton Anthology of African American Literature, 1987 to 1996. How difficult of a project was that to work on? How do you decide who or what to include in an anthology and that will serve as an important text? And is it a time to update the Norton Anthology?
Certainly for the first part of the question, you're asking the wrong person. Yes, I was nominally involved in that, but that would be a better question for the people who are more at the foreground. Can't
like
ask
anymore
because, bless her heart, Nellie is not with us. You could ask Bill Andrews, you could ask others, but I just... Can't
well, let's look at, well, let me ask you this way. Let me ask you this question. You're teaching a class. How helpful is the Norton Anthology? Are there people, for example, you say, okay, I would like to use this anthology, but I don't like the work that they select of this particular writer? Or the fact that when the Norton Anthology came out at that time, it had to include this because, you know, of the oral tradition.
Right. I can't think of an anthology in any class I've ever taught, excuse me, used an anthology, it was always supplemented. right? There were longer works you wanted to teach than the stuff that was in the anthology. There were works that you felt were more important or more important to a thematic you were trying to carry through to the class, or that you, as the semester developed, gee, these people are really into X and we've been kind of doing Y, and so let's get some X thrown in there. An anthology is what an anthology is. I think, you know, the anthology did get one sort of going through, and is it time? It's probably always time for another one. Two things are involved there, right? The primary one is, does the company holding the rights
we might say that is because if you look at just the genre of poetry, I mean, we have like a Kaveh Kanem, okay? So what happened right there, the number of people that are just emerging from that group, you know, and that's just would be the poetry section, let alone we can look at the abundance of fiction writers that have emerged. And so I just looked at, you know, what we see happening. But let's turn to something which I think I really want to get your comments on. When we think of African-American novelists, one thinks immediately of Richard Wright, Ralph Ellison, Toni Morrison, Alice Walker. Where do we place Percival Everett? And why is there a Percival Everett International Society?
Some fools like me believe that he is the most exciting African-American writer since Toni Morrison. Colson Whitehead is certainly more prominent and is very talented. Lots of other people are out there who are very talented. I'll speak for me. He is the most wide-ranging and in terms of his subject matter, in terms of how he approaches things, in terms of how he works philosophies of many, many sorts into his work, how his work keeps talking to itself in different ways. You know, he refers to what he does as one big novel, mm-hmm. and it kind of is. Threads that were sewed in the 80s get picked up some other way, and so on and so forth. He is intellectually challenging. He's one of the most brilliant people I've ever met.
Let me make it a little difficult for you. I'm a PhD student. I want to do my thesis. I come into you and I say, okay, I don't want to do it. I want to do Percival Everett. How do you guide me as a student, as your student? How do you guide me through? Like, for example, what would you say? I think you should begin with these novels in this order, or you might say to me, I think it's too ambitious to do all these books. Just focus on maybe this one novel and, you know, be an expert on, like, say, Song of Solomon.
You're really asking a couple questions there. One is how do you get a PhD student in general? and the answer to that one is you work with the person to find out what they have in mind and, you know, what's doable within a certain amount of time and space and so on and so forth. And, you know, I've worked with people who are go for the breadth and people who focus in. My personal inclination would be to say you focus in. I mean, especially to somebody who's written 30 plus.
So what do you tell me to, what do you encourage me to focus on? I'm in your office right now. What do you tell me to focus on?
Well, what are you interested in?
Well, I tell you, my favorite book is Erasure. You know, I like
that's,
it for its humor.
That's
I like it.
Number one.
Okay. You know, but then, you know, I started out, you know, when he had his first book, Suitor, you know, I mean, because I like baseball, you know, but I mean, then it's Tree. I mean, there's so many books there that if I try to put it into one, say, thesis, it's very, unless I say, I guess back to this in society, I guess if you have a lot of people studying Percival Everett, there must be some common ground or common agreement about what is he doing.
There's certainly common agreement, if you just look at the volume of scholarship, that Erasure is this big novel. And certainly that was his breakthrough novel. And in a lot of ways, it's an incredibly important novel. Interestingly, it was in books. You could go through bookstores in Paris and London and see it in the windows of the bookstores much more than the U.S., in part because of some of the theoretical underpinnings of his work, and in part because people just loved it. It's unsurprising to me that Italy's the other place who really has gotten off on Everett. And there's a woman now who's done a film about Everett's work that's going to be released apparently in the not too distant future.
Are there any novels that you would, you know, just a large number, are there any novels that you feel have been overlooked that people need to really go and examine? They don't get the recognition that say Erasure, but they're very important.
You know, they could start with Erasure. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you what I mean by that, and then I'll more directly answer your question. There's a section about midway through Erasure called Apropos de Bots, translated insignificant, this means nothing. And it's a chapter that is not connected in a direct way to anything else that's in the book and so on and so forth. And so one of the things I published about Everett is unpacking, you know, why is that important? So there's always places that, you know, that you can really dig in and try to understand him. And one of the things that's very interesting to me about him is that there are levels and levels and levels. And the books also really do talk to each other in profound kind of ways, not just thematics, but sometimes characters. His book, the Trees, that got so much attention, really owes a debt back to a book that you basically can't get unless you go to a library. It was a small press book, not his best work, but called the Body of Martin Aguilera. I came upon the Body of Martin Aguilera, finding out there was such a thing and asking, first of all, how the hell do I get my hands on this book? And it has these sort of corpses coming and going under suspicious circumstances and so on and so forth, which feeds in a, you know, in a direct way, even though it is, that a smoke alarm? There's no smoke. It feeds in a direct way into the trees.
You know, when we look at Percival Everett, I wouldn't want to attach a label that we sometimes hear, experimental, but there is a need at some time to describe writers who are experimental. And I wonder if you could go from talking about Percival Everett's work to Clarence Major.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that attracts me to fiction is, for lack of a better term, experiment, atypical form. And humor. Both of those are abundant in Everett, less humor with Clarence, but probably his formal work, especially during that period when he was publishing with the Fiction Collective, mm-hmm. It's out there.
Right. Reflex and burn structure, I remember.
Yeah, I mean, characters who have names degenerate into he, she, or one, two, and so on and so forth. You find out at the end of a novel that, it's a whodunit kind of novel. And at the end of the novel, The narrator kind of comes on stage and does the ending and says, "I'm the narrator. I can control what I want to do. Ha ha." That's not everybody's cup of tea. Mm-hmm. But it is something that's interesting to me. It has to be more than fun and games. I mean, I've got sort of interested in the fiction collective for a while, a number of really good writers there. But too much of it was just play for the sense of, for me, was play for the sense of play.
Let's look at something that I wonder where people, when we talk about Percival Everett and we talk about Clarence Major, someone would say from like maybe the 1970s through the 80s, especially, African-American women writers came to the forefront, you know? And so what happens is that when we think of our best-selling writers, you know, we immediately think of Alice Walker and Terry McMillan. And so I see all these books that Percival's putting out, but, you know, many times people were not focusing on the book clubs, for example, were not focusing on the sure. African-American male writers. So I wonder whether that was a problem. In terms of people being overlooked.
Good writers being overlooked is always a problem, I suppose. But yeah, I mean, the publishing industry is that, mm-hmm. an industry. And, you know, some writers choose to, or wind up publishing with major publishing houses that want to do this, that, or the other thing. Others, independent publishers who will kinds of work. He's got a novel that's going to be coming out next year, supposedly, mm-hmm. of retelling Huck Finn through Jim's perspective. Right. But he, you know, he can do that. But if writers are trying to stay in the mainstream, and the kind of writers that got buoyed up in the mainstream, whether it's once you mentioned Alice Walker, et cetera, et cetera. Not that there isn't a lot of value there, but does the space for writers in general gets closed down? The space for writers of a particular ethnicity get closed down more in terms of getting broad circulation?
Well, then my last question, Joe Weixlmann, is this. Talk about the importance of doing comparative studies, comparing African-American writers with Black writers of the Caribbean and South America, as well as African writers and Black writers living in Europe. What might be the common themes? Might we be encouraging a new generation of scholars to become more fluent in Spanish and Portuguese?
Wow. Especially the last part of that, I hadn't given a lot of thought to. Certainly we know, right, that there is in the world we live in now and have lived in for some decades now, cross currents that we see and know what should be done to especially encourage it. I don't know, you know, a number of writers have crossed that divide and have made use of that. Should we be teaching more people Spanish? Well, we should be teaching more people Spanish, including myself, for a host of reasons, I suppose. I don't know where else to go with that.
Well, that's the unfinished gender. There's a lot more work to do. But Joe, I want to thank you for taking time out and talking to me. I've always had a lot of admiration, you know, for you as a person and the work that you've done over the years. And so this has been an honor just to, you know, have an exchange.